Yeah, good morning, everybody. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here in Düsseldorf, University Düsseldorf. And we are here in a lecture hall of the Roy Lichtenstein Foyer. You have probably already seen that we have a very famous painter who was responsible for making this space very nice and very unique. And I hope very much that our course will also be nice, unique for you, that you will learn a lot, and that you will enjoy the next 5 days. The program is focusing on atlasing, and atlasing means somehow taming brain complexity. And the brain is really a very amazing organ. And it's amazing because of the 86 billion nerve cells, or here I calculated with 100 billions, because if you just estimate that every cell has about 10,000 synapses, and each synapse can have, roughly speaking, two different states, on or off, then you end up with this gigantic number, which of course cannot be calculated by any computer at this moment. And of course, this is only a theoretically possible number of states that the brain can have, and we can reduce it, for instance, by knowing the rules by which the brain is functioning. But on the other hand, this is a state only at one moment of time, and you are aware, of course, that the brain is changing in milliseconds, in years, in days, and during the whole lifespan. And the brain is able to learn. It has it is a basis for incredible scales. It's relatively small. It's only 1.3 liter or a little bit more, and it has only 10 watt energy consumption, which makes it so interesting for people developing neuromorphic devices. At the same time, the brain is also the reason why we have so many patients with really severe brain diseases, and brain diseases touch our humanity very directly, and sometimes they change the personality of people, which makes it really so difficult also to cope with them, not only we as physicians, but also we as relatives or friends. And there are really severe deficits, for instance, after stroke, loss of language, and depression is really a major issue, which is very widely distributed in the population, and most of us have at least one episode of depression in our lives. There are more than 3 million dementias expected in Germany until 2015, so this number is growing. And a big question is, of course, how to approach such complex brain organization and approach its disorders. And I emphasize the disorders aspect because I'm convinced that as brain researchers, we have also the responsibility to contribute something to clinical neuroscience to make better therapies and drugs. And since this is such a gigantic project, the Human Brain Project was found in 2013 with the mission of understanding the human brain. And the idea behind was that we can get profound insights into what makes us human. So these are, for instance, aspects of philosophy, ethics, society, but also to build revolutionary computing technologies. You will learn more about it, and develop new treatments for brain disorders. And we think that since neuroscience and ICT, information and communication technique, are very mature, now that we are, so to say, at the reach and can solve, or can start to solve this question. And the Human Brain Project is a 10-year project. We are now in the so-called second specific grant agreement phase, which goes from this year, from April to 2020. And we are about at half time. And in this period, we are trying to develop a European infrastructure, a so-called joint platform for brain research to bridge the different scales of human brain organization. And I come back to these different scales very shortly, because it's one of the key concepts that we are here following. But just to give you a short overview about the HBP, it is receiving now in this funding period for 2 years 88 million, not 89. The core project includes 116 European institutions, 19 countries, and there are about 500 researchers involved. It is subdivided into 12 disciplinary sub-projects. We are involved in various initiatives, which are sometimes national initiatives, sometimes European initiatives. We had a quite far-going reorganization during SGA1, start now SGA2, first few months, have new advisory committees, scientific and clinical advisory, who help us to identify research directions. And we try to bring together all the different fields of research, that is physicists, informaticists, philosophers, neuroscientists, neurologists, and so on and so forth, through so-called co-design projects. And co-design means that neuroscientists work together with informaticists, technicians, engineers, to develop jointly the joint platform, that is a research infrastructure. And this is so critical, because if you have only engineers, then the platform is perhaps very cool, but they are not. This is not really useful for neuroscientists. And many of us have seen failing initiatives in that respect. If you have only neuroscientists, then they are sometimes very good programmers, but usually neuroscientists do not go to such a level of maturity in their software programming that it's really easy to be applied for a new doctoral student who comes from psychology. So this is simply not our work as neuroscientists. So the solution is to bring them together. And this is what we call co-design projects or use cases. So use case means we have a certain neuroscientific question, and then we are developing together with engineers a technical solution and make sure that it's really good for us as neuroscientists. So that's a little bit the idea behind this project. And in that sense, it's a very special project. It's not just a neuroscientific project which aims at understanding the brain. It's a neuroscientific project that builds a joint platform, therefore, hand in hand with neuroscientists to make neuroscience a better science in the future. And this is necessary indeed, because the brain has such a complex organization. And when you think about it, you have a molecular or genetic level of brain organization. You have a level of single cells. Single cells form small circuits. They are organized on the so-called mesoscopic cells, where you see the cellular architecture, the connectivity architecture, including large functional systems which are involved, for instance, in a certain language task or in visual processing. At the end, we have also the influence of the environment, and people are communicating with each other. And also communication and interaction with the environment goes back, for instance, to the molecular organization of the brain. And to understand really what does it mean if you have a certain cell type in a certain brain region? What does it mean for the involvement of the certain region in a particular cognitive function or in a certain behavior? Or vice versa, what does it mean if a subject is living, for instance, in bad environmental conditions with a lot of stress, alcohol, cigarettes, all these factors? We know it's bad, but how precisely does it work? Yeah, where does it work? Does it go to the cells, to the molecules? Does it change the genes? We know it from epigenetics. So to understand this, I mean, it's really difficult, and it is so difficult because the brain is built on these different levels in space and time. It's a complex system. That means sometimes very small changes in the conditions have a huge effect, and sometimes it is very stable, and we do not really understand why the brain is behaving like that. So there are huge challenges with respect to research, and we solve it by neuroscience. This is empirical work in the wet lab, for instance, experiment, but also theory. And on the other hand, we are using more and more a research infrastructure which involves, for instance, data analytics and simulation. So other communities, like astrophysicists, they are using simulation for a long time because they cannot do experiments with stars and planets. Yeah, and there it is more or less clear. We have only 1.5 kilograms, but still we cannot do experiments in all respects. So simulation is a very interesting tool. And data analytics is also very important if you think about large cohort studies of 1,000 brains, as we are doing it here in Jülich and Düsseldorf, 1,000 brains cannot be just run with a little Excel sheet in the background, and you need more powerful computers. And another answer to this multi-level brain organization problem is, of course, to develop a good atlas. And good atlases are known for quite a long time. And this is a map that Vasco da Gama has used in order to find India. And India was so interesting because there were a lot of herbs, and he wanted to have a way to go through the ocean to India, as in contrast to the way through the different countries, because this was quite dangerous. And Vasco da Gama had very good maps at that time available, and he had very good estimates about the distance between Portugal in that sense and India. This was not the case for Columbus. And Columbus a little bit underestimated the distance, and so therefore he decided to go to the west. He thought this is a closer distance as compared to the east. And he did not find India, he found America, which was also cool, of course, and it's a big endeavor, but imagine you have to explain your funders that unfortunately you are not in India, but you are in the US. And it's always good to have a good map, at least to be aware where you are, where you can have a stopover, and how to plan your travel. And this is a little bit what we want to do also with our brain mapping approach that we want to bring closer to you these days. So a starting point of brain mapping is to analyze the cytoarchitectonic subdivision of the cerebral cortex. And here you see a horizontal section in which two areas are being labeled, FP1 and FP2, in blue and in red, and they are in the frontal pole. And earlier maps suppose that there's only one area, so-called area 10, which is so specific for the human brain, but only one. So we have found two areas by using a method, an observer-independent way to map the cerebral cortex into two areas. The cerebral cortex is shown here. You see the different layers from 1 to 6, and the green line indicates where the border between two areas is. And this is based, for instance, on differences in this sublayering and in the cell packing density of layer 3, for instance. And we can quantify the localization of the border by using a multivariate tool that helps us to compare the architecture of the cerebral ribbon step by step, so to say, and to identify quantitative criteria by which we can set a border between cytoarchitectonic areas. And this is a big progress because it makes such mapping more independently from the researcher. Not fully independently, but at least it helps to map it in a reproducible, reliable way. And this was a big step forward. And using this method, we are mapping a serial section, that is neighboring sections, over the whole extent of areas. And when we have mapped the extent of the areas, we can introduce them into the so-called U-brain atlas, which is an atlas that is based on the mapping of 10 postmortem brains. And every color here identifies one single area. You will learn about it more during the course of this week. Cytoarchitecture, of course, is only one parameter that is characteristic for brain organization. And receptor architecture is another very important aspect, which brings closer to us molecular organization of the brain. So what do we mean here? There are different neurotransmitters, for instance, acetylcholine or glutamate or GABA, and they bind to specific molecules, so-called receptors. And a neurotransmitter can have different receptors to which it can bind, and you see it here for acetylcholine, which has two here on the picture, M1 and M2, two muscarinic receptors. And what we see when we visualize the receptor densities in this human brain section, then there is a different concentration of the receptors in different brain region, but also within one brain region when you look to different layers and sublayers. And since these are key molecules for signal transduction, we can assume that they have a very important role for brain function. And it is very natural that they are different in different brain regions, because brain regions are also involved in different functions. And beyond that, we see that receptors are not only important to understand the function of a brain region, but they are also important to understand the dysfunction of a brain region. So as you can see here, for instance, in these two pieces coming from the hippocampal region, from a control brain and from an Alzheimer brain, and you see immediately that the Alzheimer brain has a much lower receptor density of this particular cholinergic muscarinic M1 receptor as compared to the normal healthy brain. And indeed, drugs which are using this effect, these are more or less the only drugs that are used in very early stages of Alzheimer. So they are not so powerful as we would expect, unfortunately, but at least this is a solution. So when we understand the receptor architecture, when we understand how it is changed in patients, at least we have a good neuroscientific theoretical basis to develop better drugs. Another possibility to analyze the human brain is through the integration of data and knowledge from existing databases. And for instance, for patients with neurodegenerative disorder, there is a so-called ADNI database, which has collected brain scans of patients at different stages. And this is a unique database from the US. And the question is, how can we make sure that this very good database, for instance, is integrated or linked with our cytoarchitectonic atlas that we are developing here? So we have to develop interfaces between these large tools. And the same is also true for functional maps, ANIMA database or BrainMap.org. These are databases which are providing information about the functional segregation of the human brain, so which brain region is involved in which particular executive functions, for instance, or language. So this is also a way. The 1,000 brain study from here could also be integrated. And in order to do that, we need some way of standardized processing, and we need big computers, because there's a lot of space requirement and there's a lot of processing. And if you have tried to analyze 1,000 brains using SPM or FSL, you will very quickly see this is a big step. And if you have a very complex general linear model, for instance, then it becomes even more difficult. So we are also developing these links to high-throughput computing, for instance. Imaging itself also is developing very quickly, and you will see it on Thursday when you are in Maastricht. They have very high field MR imaging systems, and with these very high field, they can observe within the brain, within a certain brain area, how certain pieces are reacting. For instance, when the brain of a subject is switching between two different interpretations of stimuli. So this view, this change of the perspective is imaged in the brain, and you will see more examples, of course, on Thursday. So this ultra high resolution imaging and databases and receptor organization and cyto organization will brought by this project into an atlas. And of course, the idea is that this atlas can be used online independently from where you are. And indeed, after this week, you are all going home, and we want you make use of this atlas independently from whether you are in Jülich or Düsseldorf or not. And to develop these web-based atlases, online atlases, was really a challenge, because sometimes the data are really big and you want to handle the data, and our engineers really worked long and hard in order to achieve that. But now the atlas is more and more being populated with different types of data, for instance with the cytoarchitectonic maps, and you can manipulate the atlas, and you can also introduce different sectioning angles if you prefer to see the brain from another perspective. So there are different areas colored here in this atlas. You can slice it and it really goes quite quickly and very fast. And then there are different options. For instance, there are options to pick out a certain architectonic area, to have a look to a probabilistic map of this particular area, to learn more about where is a reference that tells you more about this area. You may not know it, so you would like to read. This information is, for instance, there. And then there is other information for this area that can also be downloaded. So for instance, there is receptor data for a certain architectonic area, not for all available, but for many. And you can see the quantitative description of this receptor data for this specific area. And our teams are working in order to bring more and more receptor data to this atlas and share it with the community. And then you can really use it for your own research. We are going also in the direction of introducing dynamic data, for instance, data about electrodes which are put into the brain of patients before epilepsy surgery. And indeed, it is also very important to understand the dynamic aspect of brain organization, and you would, as a neurosurgeon, you would perhaps like to know more precisely in which area your electrodes are and what are the effects independent on the different areas. So this is a little bit the idea of this atlas, and there are also quite complex tools in this atlas. For instance, the UGEX tool, and this tool allows to link cytoarchitectonic areas and information with gene expression data as it comes from the Allen Brain Institute in Seattle. So they have sectioned 6 human postmortem brain and analyzed gene expression data, put that into a reference space, and this tool just helps you to combine these two different types of data and to ask the question which receptors, for instance, are important in order to distinguish a motor area from a visual area or one language area from the other language area. So you can answer such questions. You will learn more in this course about supercomputing, and there is a tour to the supercomputing center in Jülich. In fact, there are more supercomputing centers from whole Europe which are behind, and at the end you will not notice where your data are being processed or where your data are being stored. So the idea is that these 5 supercomputing centers, perhaps more in the future, they provide the basis of allowing to run very computing intensive, time intensive jobs, simulation or data analytics, or when you have to store data which are really huge. And data are sometimes really huge when you think about the cellular level of resolution. So if you just imagine that there is one single section in the brain with a 1 micrometer resolution, this is what you see here, then it ends up as 200,000 pixels in each direction. And this means that for one single brain, you end up with 2 or 3 petabytes of data, just for one brain at the cellular level of resolution. So this is a lot of data, and most of the universities and most of the research centers simply do not have 2 petabytes just free for one single brain of you in person. But the advantage of this big consortium is that you can go to these resources and use them. And there are also, of course, data on the electron microscopic level, which are very intensive in terms of storage. This is also true for the connectivity, and you will see more about connectivity, fiber tracts also in these days. This is an example of 2 images coming from the mouse brain and from the human hippocampus. And for us, it is very important to understand what are the similarities and what are the differences between the species. Obviously, the human brain is not just a bigger mouse brain. Yeah? So it's not just the question that the mouse brain is this and the human brain is this. There are more profound differences. This is easy. But where precisely are the similarities? Where can we infer, for instance, if we have a nice knockout model of a mouse, where can we transfer this knowledge to a disease, and where we cannot transfer it? Are the molecules the same in mouse and in human brain? Yes, perhaps, but not completely. And such data or such comparisons are really important in order to understand the differences. There's another bridge that we have to bridge. This is a multi-scale connectivity. So we can analyze connectivity using diffusion MRI. This is really good because we can analyze living subjects, patients for instance. We can see what they are doing in the scanner. We can instruct them. We can select different samples of people, men and women, or healthy or diseased people. But unfortunately, the spatial resolution is not so great. Yeah? It goes a little bit less than 1 millimeter, but that's it. Considering that myelin, that fibers surrounded with myelins are in the range of 10, maybe 20 micrometer, but usually not more, this is of course not enough. And polarized light imaging is creating a method that allows you to analyze fiber tracts on this micrometer range in the human brain and also for the whole brain. Then you have to further go down, for instance, to photomicroscopy, which allows you to analyze the subcellular organization of the brain, but not the whole brain, unfortunately. So there is no really method for connectivity which answers all your questions. Yeah? Either you have the whole brain, then the resolution is not good enough. When you have an excellent resolution and can indicate all the cells, you do not have the whole brain. When you have the resolution, you have not living human subjects. When you have living human subjects, you do not have cells. So these are a little bit the dilemmas in which we are, and that means we really have to combine the different methods. And that means also that when you have these little volumes of interest, very often it makes sense to register them to the atlas because you cannot analyze the whole brain. And we have developed in the last 2 years a tool that allows you to align these small pieces, for instance, which were obtained during neurosurgery or from a postmortem study where you are not happy enough to get the whole brain, but also a small piece. So to link this to the whole brain atlas and to make a spatial representation in this whole human atlas. And this is shown here, for instance, from a piece coming from the hippocampus, the fiber information. This is a colored information, and it is brought into the reference space of the so-called big brain reference template, which then includes more and more information coming from the different groups in the world approaching the brain. Yeah, so I would like to thank you. You can have, of course, short questions to me, short because I'm a little bit slower than I expected, but please feel free to give any questions now. Thank you for coming at the end.